Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to this meeting of your Los Angeles City Council. Today is Friday, June 16th, 2023. I'm Paul Krikorian, President of the City Council, and we're ready to begin today's meeting. We will be taking public comment today, both in person here in the Council Chamber and via teleconference. So if I can call this meeting to order, please, Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Blumenfeld, De Leon, Harris, Dawson, Hernandez, Hutt, Krikorian, Lee, McCosker, Park, Price, Rahman, Rodriguez, Soto Martinez, Yaroslavsky. 10 members present and a quorum, Mr. President.
Thank you. First order of business.
Approval of the minutes from June 14, 2023.
Councilmember McCosker moves. Councilmember Hernandez seconds. Next.
Commendatory resolutions for approval.
Councilmember Blumenfeld moves. Councilmember Hutt seconds. Next. Let's run through the agenda, please.
Thank you. Yes, items 1 through 20 are items for which public hearings have been held. Government Operations Committee reports have been submitted for items 17, 18, 19, and 20 and posted to those respective council files. Items 21 through 26 are items for which public hearings have not been held. 10 votes are required for consideration.
Very good. Without objection, those items are now before us. Members, do you have any items that you would like to call special among those items? Any specials? Any specials on the left? Any specials on the right? Councilmember Hutt.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to call number 22 special for some amendments.
22 for an amendment?
Correct.
Okay, and is the amendment available yet?
Not yet.
Okay, so we'll hold that one on the desk. Any other specials? Councilmember Soto Martinez.
Council President, item 4 for comments, please.
Very good. We'll hold item 4 for comments. Any other specials, members? Going once, going twice. All right. Then, Madam Clerk, what's available for us to vote on now?
The council may now vote on items 1 through 3 and 5 through 20.
All right, those items are now before us. Let's go ahead and open the roll. Close the roll and tabulate the votes.
10 ayes.
Very good. Thank you. Before we begin public comment for today's meeting, I would like to recognize Councilmember Marquise Harris-Dawson, who has a very special presentation today. So, Mr. Harris-Dawson, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody, and thank you, Mr. President. I'm proud this morning to stand at this podium and give a special honor and recognition to our one of our most outstanding members of this body, longstanding members of this body, the one and only council member, Nate Holden of the 10th Council District. Mr. Holden has a very distinguished career, very distinguished record here in this body, in the state legislature, and in the community writ large. I won't go over the whole thing. His Wikipedia page is really, really, really long. You have to scroll down a few times to get to all his accomplishment. But besides being a man who truly loved the community and was willing to fight with this council, with whoever was mayor at the time, I think he went through a handful of mayors. Besides that, he was able to do something all of us should strive to do, and I think do strive to do. And that is create something that changes the lives of people in Los Angeles and people outside this city that lasts long after you are gone from this body. And 30 years ago, we celebrate 30 years this year, Mr. Holden started a program that dozens of cities and counties across the state have picked up, that the city of Los Angeles continues until this day. And it is remains, again, one of the best moments I had as a council member was a few weeks in, we donated fire trucks to Nigeria. I learned that that program is based on a program that Mr. Holden started where we first donated sanitation trucks to the city of Tijuana. Now that does a few things. It helps the environment because we're not manufacturing new trucks when we don't need to. It creates goodwill for the city of Los Angeles, and so every Angeleno that goes around the world and visits a city, that people in that city can say, well, your city donated this to us, or your city gave us street lights, or your city gave us fire trucks. Also, it helps the people of that community advance maybe more quickly than they might and have a higher quality of life than they should. And so today we are here to honor Nate Holden for starting that program 30 some odd years ago. A round of applause for Councilmember Holden. The councilman is joined by his family, friends. I think I see some former staff of the Council District 10. And of course, our good friend and assembly member, Chris Holden. Let's give him a big round of applause. Mr. President, we have a short slideshow, but I want to recognize and ask to come to the mic my colleague and the current council member of the 10th District, Council Member Heather Hutt.
Thank you. Thank you, Council Member. Thank you, Mr. President. Nate Holden, better known as the Chief, led the way in public service for the 10th District, and we can still feel that today. He was an Army veteran, a state senator, a council member, and he served in these chambers from 1987 to 2003. He was the person that broke up our district into grids so that he could make sure that constituents got real service, and he is service-minded. He helped streamline services because he required deputies to drive the grid to report bulky items, potholes, long before we had 311. And I understand from many of your staff that you would call an area and say, hey, I'm on Carmona and Pico. Did you pick up that mattress that was there 2 days ago? And they would say yes, and you'd say, no, I'm standing here right now. You ain't picked up nothing. I'm trying to follow in your footsteps to make sure that the deputies do what they're supposed to do to bring constituents the services they deserve. Your urgency to serve the people is legendary and has helped change the way of giving internationally, like Councilmember Harris Dawson just said, and directly impacts the environment and our constituents. I want to say thank you for your leadership. Thank you for your service. Thank you for coming and gracing us with in the chambers today. We all believe that you deserve your flowers. So thank you.
Thank you so much. So in recognition of you, Mr. Holden, of what became Article 12, donation of surplus city equipment of the Los Angeles City Charter, and its 30-year life, we present to you this plaque that I'm sure you've presented to a person or two during your time. And so we're going to bring a mic around so you don't have to go through this maze. Your son has you want to sit at the table? Okay. Mr. Holden tells me he's going to sit at the table, Mr. President. So.
Councilmember Holden and Assemblymember Holden, we're delighted to welcome you to the front table.
Or some of the other members are going to speak before I do.
Councilmember, it is entirely your preference. Let me first call on Councilmember McCosker.
I relish this moment because I sat in that chair so many times as you were questioning me over the many, many, many years. Councilman Holden, it is such a delight to be with you here today. I'm reminded that the first time I met you, I was a young lawyer in the mid-90s probably, and I wanted to talk to the great supervisor, Kenny Hahn, and he was at an event and you were staffing him. And I remember tapping you on the shoulder and asking permission if I could speak to the supervisor, and you guided me to him and sat with us when we had the first visit. And that was when the supervisor told me, you should talk to this man right here and you need to work for my son someday. But that's not the greatest memory I have. The greatest memory that we've shared is on one of those days, I don't know if it was in the city attorney's office or in the mayor's office, I was here in council and I had a very, very, very bad day, and there were a lot of them. And I remember going back up to my office. I was combination angry and upset and embarrassed, and I was in my office. Actually, I remember exactly where it was because it was in the mayor's office. My phone rang, I picked it up, Councilman Holden. And Councilman Holden said, Tim McCosker, stand up, turn around, put me on the speakerphone. I want to talk to you for a minute. Look out your window. Is the sky blue right now? Are the trees green? Do you hear birds singing? Is it a beautiful day? I said, yes, sir. Yes, sir, it is. He goes, don't take this work seriously, but don't take yourself so seriously. Enjoy the moment you're in. Do the best you possibly can and move on. And that was like the best advice I could have possibly have gotten on a tough day. And I think about it a lot. And everyone in my family knows that you did that for me. And on tough days, people remind me, don't forget, and my kids, I'm sorry, call you Uncle Nate. Don't forget Uncle Nate. And remember, just look out the window and don't take yourself so seriously. And just do the best job you can and move on. So I thank you so much for being my mentor and being a friend and being such a generous person to the city of Los Angeles, but particularly to me and to my family. So thank you and God bless you.
And Councilmember Holden, and Assemblymember Holden, did you want to make comments as well?
I can. Thank you, President Kerkorian. You know, it is an honor for us as a family to be here today to sort of witness this family wrapping their arms around my dad. You know, he's always been such a fixture in LA politics, and certainly he's relished his time on the city council and the kinds of work he's been able to do, your predecessors and others who have served with him, and the good work that has come out of this building. And I'm just proud of the fact that he has taken public service to a whole nother level. I've learned from him. I know many of you have been inspired by his leadership. It's always the small things that he would always point out to me. He said, make sure that the constituents are hearing you and that you're listening to them and you're responding to their needs. Make sure the mattresses are out of the alleys, the trees are trimmed. I remember one instance where he was running for re-election and he knocked on a door, or one of his staff, I won't say who, knocked on a door and came back to him and said, you know, boss, they're not going to support you. He said, what are you talking about? He said, well, they got the opponent sign in the yard and they're not going to support you. Tell me who they are. Point me in the direction. So he walked over and knocked on the door. And the person came out and said, you know, Mr. Holden, you've done a great job, but the trees, they haven't been trimmed in a long time. And he said, I'll take care of it. He went back to his car. He called Public Works. The next day, the whole street, the trees were trimmed. He went back. He said, what do you think now? He said, take that sign out of my yard and put your sign in it. You're my guy. And that's the kind of leadership that he brought and continues to bring. And I'm inspired by him even today and the good work that we try to do. If I could, I'd like to introduce my family who's here. My wife, Melanie, who's sitting in the front row. My son, grandson, Nicholas Holden, who, by the way, works for Supervisor Hahn. And my daughter, Mariah Holden. So if we could just welcome them.
Welcome.
But thank you, and thank all of you for this wonderful honor today.
Thank you very much. And I just want to say, first of all, Councilmember Holden, welcome back to your chambers, a place that you served for 16 years. And Councilmember Harris-Dawson and Councilmember Hutt mentioned a few of the legacy accomplishments that you had, but there could be so many more. As Mr. Harris-Dawson said, we could list these for a long time, but a few that just, especially for the younger people who are here, I think it's important that we talk about your role in history and how rapidly things have changed since you served here. If it weren't for Nate Holden, California would not have been the first state in the country to recognize the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday, setting the tone for the rest of the nation. If it weren't for Nate Holden, California would not have changed its law that required women acquiring a mortgage to have a man sign the document along with them. That's the sort of thing that happened within the career of this man. If it weren't for Nate Holden, this city would not have prohibited the production and distribution of realistic toy guns that led to the death of so many young people because they were just simply out there playing with a toy gun. But Nate Holden saw that as being a problem and fixed it. And you could go on with some of the contributions that this career in public service that council member Nate Holden has given to this city has really changed lives and made a difference for people. The Nate Holden Performing Arts Center continues to enrich South Los Angeles and continues to uplift people because of your work. So we're all, not just the people of the 10th District and not just the people of South Los Angeles, but everyone in Los Angeles is grateful to you for your extraordinary career of service. And I have to say one other thing. There was a picture of you with Antonio Villaraigosa in there, and he looked about, I don't know, 40 years younger, and you haven't changed a bit. So, Councilmember Nate Holden.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And before I make any further comments, some of my former staff people are here. Will they just stand and be recognized? Many moons ago, after I left the California State Senate, and prior thereto, I served with Supervisor Kenneth Hahn. When I got to the California State Senate, they had a Me Too operation going. You know, one guy says something, they said Me Too. Another guy said Me Too. And there's people in the state was not that happy with the non-performance. They didn't vote for Me Too. They voted for individuals who are going to go and assume those positions, do the best they could do to represent the thinking and the desires of the people of the state of California. So I happened to make a number of changes up there. For example, one of the major issues I worked on was anti-redlining, where they were not providing loans for people in geographically on areas where the federal government was providing programs for homes in those areas at one given point. When the war started, the president took the money away and put it in the front of the war. So the mortgage company, lending companies, refused to invest in that operation. Well, I got it moving. I told them that you have to do that. Stop. You have to provide loans within certain geographic areas as you would in other areas. To make a long story short, went held up by the committee, and I call these individuals to come to my office, see if we could work something out. They came to my office, and I, very prominent, important people representing the banking lending institution in the state of California. I turned my back on them. Made a point. I turned my back, put my feet on my top of my desk, and looked out the window. And then I turned around my chair quickly. And I said, why are you here? Demoralized them a little bit. They figured they didn't have the power. The elected officials had the power. Question is, what do you do with it? If you have the power, you got to work for the people. So I turned to them and I says, I tell you what, you're refusing to loan money to finance projects in mortgage deficiency areas. I will do that, just like in Chicago. And when you decide it's going to be profitable once again, I'm going to open up my violin case, turn around and go tat-a-tat-tat-tat and a tat-tat-tat. They say, oh, Mr. Holden, we can withdraw our opposition. And that's how I was able to get through. The Federal Loan Bank Board adopted this law for the nation. It's called the Holden Act. The Holden genetically handling program is the same way. And the Holden lending practices is another. So they can tombstone at that particular time. The Martin Luther King bill has already been explained to you. With a guy like Duke Machen, who later became our governor, he was sitting in his chair rocking back and forth. When that bill was introduced on the Senate floor, it got to be 19 votes, 20 votes. And Duke Machen, who's from the opposite party, but a great guy, he said, Duke Machen, I. And began to get more people supporting it. And it came out. Those are good feelings in that area. And then when I left the state senate, I went back to Supervisor Hahn. And this seat opened up for the 10th district. And I ran for it. 23 people in the race. Merle Evers, very prominent, her husband, civil rights leader, was killed in Mississippi. She was very prominent. He had Homer Broom, police commander, first African-American, serving on the Board of Public Works Commission appointed by Mayor Bradley. He was running. He ended up getting Bradley's support. All of City Hall practically was supporting him. And there was some guy called Nate Holden running also. Nate Holden's not going to win. Bradley's not with him. I ran, and I came in number one. Homer Broom came in two, argumented whether or not Ms. Cox was number two. He was number two. They finally decided he was number two. But he's going to win. The Holden's not going to make it. I put out a statement. 85% of the voters of the city of 10th district voted against City Hall because all the other candidates were voting against City Hall. And I made that statement. Oh, it infuriated the mayor and others. At one point they said, we're gonna get you, Nate, we're gonna get you. Make a long story short again, when the election came up, I got 2/3 of the vote, 66% of the vote. Rolled right into office. If you keep pressing, it'll happen. So when I got elected, I came to City Hall. I had to find out how they operate here. You had 7 members on one side and 7 members on the other side. One supporting John Micker Flores, one was supporting Joy Parker to be president of the council. Pat Russell just said, lost her re-election. He was not going to be the president anymore. We had one individual, Gilbert Lindsay, who's a World War I veteran, and I'm a World War II veteran. I mean, I don't look like it, but I am. And he was not going to vote for either one of them. So I went to a guy named Councilman Browdy. I said, Browdy? I'm trying to figure how they work around here, you know, at that time. What are you, you've been in the council a long time, what do you want? He said, I want to be vice president. Really? Oh, well, that sounds good. So I went to Ferrara, and I said, John, you're going to be the president, and Brody going to be vice president. Now you got 8 votes. So it was done. It worked out very well. And these are examples that I used in order to make things happen. Where's my book? My grandson, I told him to bring my book over here. When I was told to come to City Hall, I thought I was just coming down on an issue. But I learned that they can have some celebration. I said, my birthday, they're going to have a day off on my birthday. I arranged for that. He said, that's Juneteenth. That's Monday. They said, no, we're going to have this on a Friday. Then what are they planning to do on Friday? I just learned a few days ago, you're going to be honored. I said, oh, my God, what am I going to say? So I reached back and got about 10% of my incumbent miss while in the city of L.A. The big green book, which I will not read from, but what's contained in here are a number of things. Transportation, I was chairman of transportation. At the time, we were not getting any matching funds to build a metro rail system. BART, transportation, Sacramento, San Francisco, they were getting matching funds. Ramada, Atlanta getting matching funds. Washington, matching funds. And they got matching funds because the people of that community voted to impose some type of tax on them in order to get come to matching funds. In San Francisco, it was the property transfer tax. I learned about that when I was in the Senate. I was vice chair of the Public Utilities Transit Energy Committee. It's what you do with the power that you have. So I learned about that. And so I told Kenny Supervisor Hunt, we got to have some matching funds. And we'll get some matching money. So we put Proposition A on the ballot. Proposition A provided that half-cent sales tax. And we used that to match, get federal funding from the Transportation Commission. They came back and says, we are not going to fund mass transit for Los Angeles because OMTA only provides funding if you for complete projects. And you got 13 miles going, and we don't have no funds for that. About $13 billion. I said, I tell you what we're going to do. Let's cut it and call it minimal operation segments. And you fund the first segment, $4 billion. And then the second segment, and so on. That's how we got it rolling. And when the money came in, they all lined up to take photographs. Pretty good, huh? So these are just some of the things. I mean, I'm not gonna go too much, but may I tell you just a couple of more, however. The First Interstate Bank building was located downtown LA. And there was a fire there. And people lost their lives because the fire department could only take ladders up to the seventh floor. They were saved. Eight and above, people died. Elevators opened the doors in the fire and they couldn't get off, they perished. So I said, we gotta change that. I put an ordinance in that any building, seven stories and above, must retrofit with sprinklers. Save your life. We did those things here in the city of LA. It's a wonderful city, we all love it. And it turns out that there was some opposition because the condo owners on Wilshire Boulevard didn't want to pay that extra money. Make a long story short again, what I did, I said, I'll tell you what, if you put a sprinkler at the front door and a sprinkler in the corridor, we can save some lives for sure. And that's what they did. Final story. The Central Library. The mayor wanted to do a sale lease back on the library where they burned. We put a couple hundred million dollars in that library. They want to sell it for $25 million and 20 years buy back for $25 million. Imagine today, they wouldn't have the money to buy back. And so the private sector would rip it down and build high rise. So I said, no. The vote was 14 to 1. There are a lot of 14 to 1 votes, I'm sure you know about that. 14 to 1. And they put Proposition L on the ballot. And I wrote an argument against Proposition L. Once again, the people voted to support my position. We saved the library. We have another mayor. Another mayor, 14 to 1, they want to contract at the airport, take money from and balance the budget using F. And I said, FAA is not going to let you do that. Another 14 to 1. And they did it anyway. And I said, you better put the money in trust fund because you got to pay it back, number one. And number two, they proceeded to cut all of our grants. The grants that we had coming here to support transportation and other housing projects. They didn't learn. And it turns out they had to pay the money back. We lost all the grant money. And those kind of things were happening adversely to the people of the city. Just recently, a few years ago, they tried to change the Department of Water and Power, where they give an opportunity to the private sector to own water and power. They put it on the ballot. You had a guy named Katz campaigning for it. No, it wasn't that Katz, the other congressman from the area. And we went to before the Democratic Party here locally. If you could get a good start, the mayor thought that'll happen. And I went and challenged, I was not elected. I said, that cannot happen. You cannot give away the Department of Water and Power to the private sector. With the things they do sometimes, it baffles my mind. Right, one more and I'm finished. We had
Nate, John Ferraro never would have let you do this, but go ahead. Go ahead.
You had deregulations. Governor Pete Wilson, had a measure to to Sacramento to do to deregulate the industry, the energy industry. And the mayor Reardon at the time wanted to make sure that the city be involved in that deregulation program. Wait a minute. Shh. My son was active in Pasadena, I think it was the mayor at the time. And he told me, or I told him, I said, that's not a good idea. You're going to deregulate some, you can't control what happens after you deregulate. So I was asked to put it on the agenda and vote to include the city in that deregulation program. Having been in the California State Senate, I knew the timeline for which you could amend that legislation. So I held it in committee until the time it expired where you could not have an amendment. And then they finally stupidly voted for it. And what do you think would happen? Edison sold his interest to Edison International. The commission at that time, State Energy Commission, had no jurisdiction or control over foreign energy. So it raised the rates and raised the rates. You had blackouts and brownouts. You remember those? Water and power, there was no blackouts, no brownouts. We had surplus energy that we could sell to the other parts of the state of California.
Well, Councilmember Holden,
I want to thank Harris Dodson and Ms. Hutt for, and each and every one of you for providing me this honor. I'm going to tell you that, in my view, it's a great place to work, for sure.
Thank you, and it's our honor to have you here back in your council chambers. Councilmember Nate Holden. Thank you all very much. Councilmember Holden, thank you for a life of extraordinary service to our city.
Mr. President.
We're very proud to have you here.
Mr. President, one personal privilege moment. I saved a man's life here, and I wanted to share that with you if it's okay. One of my colleagues had a major problem. And there are people asking him to leave the council. I'm not.
We have to vote on it.
No, please. I'm talking about one of my colleagues. My colleague had a problem. So what I did is that the press came to me. They say, what about your colleague? And I said, he's a guy who never supported me in my life, never gave me a vote, but I know where he come from. And I tell you this, that when a person is down, you don't kick him. And so the court, the DA, went after him. And so what I did, I took the hit. I got all kind of hate mail. And then he came back, and when his finish his term limits. I called him one day, and I said, what are you gonna do with your life? He didn't really know. I said, I'm gonna give you a job and work for me until I retired. Then I arranged for him to work for Parks and Perry to stay. And he said, and his wife said, you saved his life. And I thought it was important for me to share with you. You saved his life.
Thank you very much. Another round of applause for Councilmember Nate Holden. All right. Thank you, Councilmember Holden. Thank you, Assemblymember Holden, to your entire family. We're honored to have you with us today. I'd like to recognize now Councilmember Lee, who wants to make an announcement. Mr. Lee.
Thank you, Mr. President. Today, I'd like to welcome the Pacific Century Institute Youth Ambassadors that are here today, if you don't mind standing up. PCI is a nonprofit organization in Council District 12 that's co-founded by Spencer Kim in the mid-1980s. The founders had held organizational meetings with a vision of improving international relations between countries and intercultural relations between the various inhabitants of the Pacific Rim region. In the first years of PCI's existence, they worked to expand knowledge and dialogue about the Pacific Rim by supporting Asian studies programs at regional universities and disseminating over 200,000 Asian language books to universities and schools. Since then, PCI has been involved in a broad variety of activities designed to support its mission of promoting education and research that will build a network of bridges of understanding that crisscross the Pacific Ocean. Under PCI's mission, the youth ambassadors who are here today were able to interact with local high school students, the Korean government, and business officials in Korea as more mindful youth leaders as they become promoters of individual and societal change. Thank you very much for being here today. Big round of applause for these future leaders of Los Angeles.
Thank you very much, Councilmember Lee. Welcome. We're happy to have you here at our meeting. With that, we're ready to begin the public comment portion of our meeting. So, Madam Clerk and Mr. City Attorney, if you could please read in the instructions for comment.
Yes, thank you. And if I may, items 17 through 20, which have already been adopted, there is a request to send these items forthwith.
Without objection, that'll be the order.
As indicated on the agenda, members of the public wishing to offer public comment should call 669-254-5252 and use meeting ID number 160-535-8466 and press pound. Then press pound again when prompted for participant ID. Once admitted into the meeting, press star 9 to request to speak. When it is your turn to speak, an automated Zoom voice will ask you to press star 6 to unmute. Let me repeat, call 669-254-5252 and use meeting ID number 160-535-8466 and press pound. Then press pound again when prompted for participant ID. Once admitted into the meeting, press star 9 to request to speak. When it is your turn to speak, an automated Zoom voice will ask you to press star 6 to unmute. Thank you.
To members of the public calling in, when it is your turn to speak, please state which of the agenda items you would like to speak on. You will have 1 minute per item to speak, up to 3 minutes total, and 1 minute for general public comment. Speak to the items before beginning general public comment. We will tell you when your time is up. When speaking on the agenda items, you must be on topic. Our goal is to get through as many speakers as we can. If you are not speaking on topic, or if we cannot tell that you are speaking on topic, you will get one brief warning from me or the president. If you do not immediately and clearly get on topic, or if you again stray off topic, you will forfeit the rest of your speaking time and we will move on to the next speaker. The items open for public comment are 21 through 26. For members of the public calling in to speak, when it is your turn, an automated message from Zoom will prompt you to press star 6 to unmute yourself. If you do not do so immediately, then council staff will prompt you. If you do not immediately unmute yourself when prompted by staff, you will forfeit your time and we will move on to the next speaker. If you are listening to the council meeting on your computer, channel 35, or another device, please turn down the volume on those other devices immediately when it is your turn to speak. Because of a feedback and time delay between the live meeting and the broadcast, it will cause a lot of confusion if you continue to listen on your other devices. Finally, for the callers, please keep an ear to the phone so that you know when it is your turn to speak. Thank you. And Mr. President, we have the motion for item number 22 as well.
Yes, please, if you could go ahead and read the amendment into the record.
Yes, so it is a motion from Council District 10 for item number 22, that item number 22 be amended to reduce the amount being transferred to $1,200, with all other aspects of the motion to remain unchanged. The original amount was for $3,680.
And is there a second on that motion?
Mr. Blumenfield seconds. All right, with that, we're ready to begin public comment. So I'm gonna call out a number of names, and as I call your name, if you could make your way to the side aisle, please, on your left, so that the sergeants can direct you towards the podium. I'm going to call out first Sinboa Wright, Joe Martinez, Pedro Conde, Eric Sotelo, and Octavio Loya, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items that you would like to speak on.
We didn't hear you.
Go ahead, okay. Mr. Wright, if you could repeat your name and which item you'd like to speak on.
Definitely. Hello, my name is Simboya Wright. I'm speaking general. I'm the Vice President of Service Employees International Union, Local 721. And on behalf of President David Green, Executive Director, myself, we're speaking on behalf of over 11,000 City of Los Angeles employees that works in every department in the City of Los Angeles that keeps Los Angeles running. We're here today to say that we are ready for a fair contract. We've always stepped up to the plate when it comes to the City of Los Angeles. We worked through the pandemic. We were here, boots on the ground. All of these employees, boots on the ground. We want the city, we're asking the city council to give the CAO's office authority to bargain for these specials. We negotiated, you voted on a one-year contract, now we're asking for these specials to begin to be taken care of. So we're asking you to give the CAO the authority to make sure we have bargaining and have
Thank
a fair.
You. Thank you very much, Mr. Wright. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
It's Joe Martinez, and it's for public comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
We're here to ask for a fair shake to be able to provide for our families. The CAO promised us that we took a small contract during the pandemic when we stepped up and they were in a bind. We went ahead and we took a contract. Now, when we go ahead and ask to continue what they have promised us, now they go ahead and just said, they're gonna kick the can down the road, and they forgot what they told us. They literally told us, we've already talked to the council, they said, no, we're not gonna address anything, we'll see you guys next year. That was a straight out lie. We're part of the bargaining team, they promised us, we're here. We work and we maintain the second largest city in this country. We have kept it up. We demand respect, fairness and honesty from our city representatives that have gone out there and represent us and told us that they would help us and be there for our families and be able to help everybody in our surroundings. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Pedro Conde, public comments.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
Greetings, council members. My name is Pedro Conde, president of Los Angeles Airport Security Officers Association and bargaining rep for MOU 18, SEIU 721. I'm here today to request that you grant the CAO the authority to review and analyze the financial cost analysis report generated by the Airport Police Division. This analysis would help us better communicate with the CAO during bargaining sessions. As you may be aware, Airport Police is currently facing significant challenges in recruitment and retention, as well as mandatory overtime. Security officers at LAW will have a unique responsibility that no other security force has. Our duties include searching for firearms, improvised explosive devices, and narcotics, while also facilitating the movement of vehicular and pedestrian traffic with minimal staffing. These tasks often require us to interact with mentally unstable individuals and irate motorists, which can lead attacks to unarmed officers. Despite these challenges, we remain dedicated to serving the City of Los Angeles. We believe that fair bargaining is essential to our continued success and ability to provide the highest level of security to those who travel throughout the airport. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Yes, sir. Eric Sotelo, general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
I am a city employee that is on the MOU 14 bargaining team for SEIU. Currently, we're coming to an impasse with the CAO's office, and we would like directive from council to them to return back with the EERC to get better revised agenda for us to go ahead and continue bargaining. Right now, we have plenty of issues that are being taken care of in grievances and arbitration, which the city currently is having trouble to go ahead and maintain. We want better directives from the EERC to the CAO so we can have better bargaining. We have plenty of members here that have worked tirelessly through the pandemic as well as day to day to keep the basic fundamentals for the City of Los Angeles going. That is what we're asking, and that is what we need to keep the city up. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Octavio Loya, general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
We are here. I'm part of members at SEIU 721, and we're all here to let you know and express our frustration with the CAO's office and how they've neglected to do a fair trade and a fair contract negotiation in good faith. They've lied to us, they've lied to all our city representatives, and they haven't told them the truth about what's going on with these contracts and the disparity that some of my members here have with our families. We're all city members, we're all city employees, and we all live in this city. And for some reason, the CAO's office just feels they don't need to negotiate a fair contract with us. And we're just here to let you guys know that it's unfair, and you guys need to give them some direction so that they start negotiating with good faith and give us a fair contract. Thank you.
Thank you. And as our next speaker is coming forward, thank you. As our next speaker is coming forward, I'm going to call out a few more names. Trevor Smalley, Rafael Yanez, Patrick Batiste, Manuel Tovar, please.
Good morning, Speaker.
My name is Mark Williams. I'm here for general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
In the 9th Council District, we have interests, not issues. A councilman with no committee assignments does not promote our interests. The councilman needs to go now. We're aware of larger crimes than the change of subject crimes that he's been indicted on. It's time for him to go now. And in the 9th Council District, we choose our representatives, not this group. The councilman needs to go now. We have interests that need to be protected. when you cover crimes against children and taxpayers, bigamy indictments don't matter. We don't need somebody here for 2 years getting paid to clear their name. We have interests that need to be represented. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker.
Patrick Batiste, general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
Y'all honored Nate Holden, the Honorable Nate Holden, and he said that he was here for the people. You guys all are here for the people. And just because we work for the city doesn't mean that we're not the people. We are the people. Serve us. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Good morning. Rafael Yanez, general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
Thank you. I am also here representing SEIU 721, MOU 8, and right now we're at an impasse, and we want to make sure that all of the specials in our current contracts are resolved quickly and expeditiously. It's unfair that we're continuing to work for the city and work here every day, making sure that all of the issues are taken care of on a timely basis. And so we're here representing our union and our constituents in making sure that everything is taken care of in a timely manner. And I'm hoping that the CAO office would take care of our unresolved issues and specials in our current contract. It's only going to last for this 1 year, but yet it just seems to me that for our future contracts, I hope that the CAO takes us seriously as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. As our next speaker is coming up, I'm going to call a few more names. Candido, Arnold Sachs, and Dr. Critical Truth Bay, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Trevor Smalley, general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
As we're approaching a 30% vacancy rate in the employee staffing in the city of Los Angeles, we've been seeking to reach a fair agreement on our contract with the city. And the city has communicated that its main purpose in this contract is to address retention. Yet none of the things that we've been countered on address retention. So right now we don't have enough people to, you know, pick up the trash in a timely fashion. We have employees working mandatory overtime 4 or 5 hours a night. We don't have enough sewer workers to make sure that the sewage stays in the sewer lines where it belongs. We don't have the street services employees to keep the streets neat and safe for pedestrian and vehicle traffic. And when all these things back up and, you know, become an issue and people start calling in, it's going to be the council members' offices that are answering these calls because we don't have the clerks to answer the phones. So I'm just asking that you use your influence to make the EERC and the CAO, you know, communicate that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, I'm sorry, sir.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Good morning to everybody. My name is Manuel Tovar, and it's just a general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
First of all, thank you for taking the time. Just want to let everybody know that we do work for the great city of Los Angeles and the same city seal. We are all here as one team. I don't know why we are being divided and being disrespected. We come here every day to serve a purpose and to serve a city with honor, with dignity, and respect. I represent the city on and off the clock to the highest standards, and I am one of the biggest mentors in my district to also allow everybody else to understand how important it is to represent the city to the highest standards and give your blood, sweat, and tears on a daily basis, whether someone is watching or no one is watching. I am here to say that we will not be disrespected, nor will we come aggressively, angrily. We will do everything in the right way. And I am here to say that it is an honor to work for the city of Los Angeles, and I envision myself also in being in one of these seats in any time soon. And I just want to say thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. Which items would you like to speak on?
21, 22, and 26 in public comment.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment. Please start with the items.
And I'm going to ask those who are leaving the room if you could please keep the noise down a little bit so we can hear from the other members of the public who want to speak. Thank you. Thanks for coming down.
Thank you.
Mr. Sachs.
Item 21 refers to the Wilmington Neighborhood Council. I remember about 8 years ago that in Wilmington area, they were offering payment in pesos and Mexican currency. Who ever heard of that bullshit? Who was the city council? Oh, I remember. Wasn't that the couple used to sit in the council? How can you offer Mexican currency in the city of Los Angeles? What the fuck is that all about? Isn't that racist? Isn't that hateful? I mean, the guy screwed over so many people. It's impossible.
Speaker, I'm not sure which
number
item
you're speaking
on. Number
22 is a mural.
So would you like to...
22 is a mural. There's plenty of murals. Some people need a mural to hold on to their board of supervisors seat because they're afraid of losing it. Because he was the number one drug dealer in America. But that's a different story. He said no to his own veterans. Number 26 is women's rights. So many women are being deprived of the opportunity of equal pay. There's problems with abortion. There's problems with people, women being appointed to boards like at Metro with no voting power. What the fuck is going on? Who is in charge in the city? I heard that Karen Bass was in the House of Representatives. Nobody knows who Barack Obama was. What is going on? It's like he just was erased out of the history books. How could that happen? How could this guy say no to his own goddamn plan? It had 15,000 people signed up in Skid Row. Affordable Care Act. The Affordable Care Act, a document I'll hand him, may require most people to have minimum essential insurance coverage. That's exactly what it is. Affordable care means you have coverage. He didn't want to pay, but he's going to pay because the state of California just sued his company, LA Care Health Plan. That's his private company. This is his business address right here. 1055 West 7th Street, 10th floor.
You've been asked to stay on topic. I'm going to move you to general public comment.
That's fine. I can continue with this shit. It doesn't matter to me. They're having a blood drive at Los Angeles County Civic Center, but it doesn't dot it. Look at these figures. This is no neck. This is no neck. No feet, no hands. Why is this not white? And this is brown. So it's a brown figure. Who does it represent? Who started that bullshit? That was that bitch, Mellow Desire. She came in the board of supervisors and said, Margaret Lee Thomas, these are your people at Skid Row. They're the black people. Oh, wait, they're the brown people. Who the fuck are they? There's a lot of people invested time in Skid Row, but nobody got Barack Obama elected except Margaret Lee Thomas. Then he said, fuck you, I'm not paying. And it wasn't U-Y-O-U, it was a U. Oh no, that was a t-shirt I was wearing when I went into the board because it's all about ethics. Fuck this place.
Next speaker, please. And I'm also gonna call Andrew Grabner and Mike Greenspan.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
All available items and public comment.
Okay, so the items that are open for public comment are 21 through 26. And so you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment.
It's egregious. I don't know what else to say as the house of cards are slowly falling down. It was a great presentation by Nate Holden this morning, almost an hour. And you have hundreds of your own workers asking for minimum wage. How does that even make sense? At least $30 an hour, the maintenance, the custodians. Some of their supervisors didn't even show up, but some of y'all are getting raises as we speak. So, 25, campaign for commemorating the emancipation of enslaved African Americans. We don't need any more symbolism. McCosker and Harris Dawson, who is never here. Who is never here. So you got Binyam, who was walking up the elevator but couldn't house a black family in District 8, while the Ethiopian community gets business equity hand over foot. Mark Ridley Thomas, now Curran Price, Nuri Martinez. I mean, who else is next? District 8, District 10. You better stop playing symbolism with black families. You were warned on June 9th by Alicia Moore that Jesus is Lord. Whether you're playing God or not, he's the one that's going to change and hold you guys accountable. We want to work with you, but your self-interest is over the needs of the people. So Pedro Montes, Pablo, who worked for 25 years, can't even get $25 an hour.
So, Speaker, I'm going to ask you to stay on topic, please, or else I'm going to move you to general.
And what's your name, City Attorney? Fable number two.
No, this is just your turn to speak. Go ahead.
Personal protective equipment, LAFD, community, certs. It would be nice if LAFD certs get the pay to reflect the PPP supplies. Ryan Aubrey, District 8, if you're listening, dear, I need you to run the hell away and find another job. You got some great interns coming in, but don't corrupt them as you guys fall one by one. We want you to respect black families, first and foremost. Reparations is still not here. As you see, when Nate Holden was doing an interview, you had Arnold Sachs being offended because he was called a nigger by Herman. But we get called that every day, and it's free speech, Arnold Sachs. I would like to see equity. We don't need a banner. We don't need a banner. McCosker and Harris Dawson, while you're having a conversation, Soto, Martinez, and McCosker, do you mind? Just for 5 seconds, pretend you're listening to me. Because you're in District 15 in Watts. We supported you.
General public comment?
General public, we supported you in that seat. Where is the resources for black families in Watts, sir? We don't want a banner. Families want equity. We want the contracts that we applied for. I'm sorry, this is general public comment.
No, hold your time for 1 minute. Mr. Sachs, you have been shouting out since the beginning of this meeting. You were shouting out in response to another altercation, and you've interrupted Dr. Truthbay twice now. You're instructed to be silent or leave this meeting. I'm sorry, Dr. Truthbay. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. So we're asking that this banner that you're commemorating for descendants of slaves, we built this country. My ancestors were lynched. We were snatched. We were beaten. To this day, and all we want is equity, just like the Croatians, just like the people in San Pedro. All the resources in San Pedro poured into Watts. You understand, the Watkins ain't doing a damn thing since Ted, and he's rolling over in his grave. We got to do better with housing. Let us help you. When we're supporting you and giving you proposals, respect it. Don't have your chief of staff disrespect black constituents who's writing the plans and giving it to you. That's all I'm saying. We don't need a banner. We want equity, housing, reparations, that's all. It should be on the agenda. We ask you to cease and desist until you have us on the agenda. Not a banner. I'm saying do better. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
speak. You denied me public speaking on Wednesday, but that's okay. I'd
Speaker,
like to talk.
Which items would you like to speak on?
On 25 and public comment, sir.
Okay, you have 1 minute for the item and 1 minute for general public comment.
You know, thank you. In regards to 25, it's about banners, but for me, it's more about the continuation of talking about reparations for the black community. And I know a lot of people are against it, but really, if you look in your heart, and what happened, if when I think of all the things that the black community had to go through, even as a child watching, it was hard being a Latino, a Native American in this country, but it was still something we went through and we made it. But the black community, there's nothing, there's no excuse. And reparation, I know some of my best friends disagree with me, but it's a way of saying I'm sorry. For me, it is a way of saying I'm sorry. Let's go on to public comment. Once again, I've talked to you about the no parking zone issue that you, the previous council did on Reseda, just north of 118. There again, we're about 20 cars smoking their dope, doing all the stuff that shouldn't be on a street. And there was the police, they had it surrounded. There was an accident, there was a crime. But it's something that you folks can straighten out. You take a look at that. Make an exception to say, you know, on this street here, we can go ahead and enforce the no parking zone. That's all we're asking. Please, just make a community safe again. There are many in your community, areas like that, where this is happening too. So it's not just in the 12th district, it's in all districts. Thank you. I appreciate that we finally get some resolve on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, All right, Speaker. I'll just do general comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
All right, so I'll just start off by saying that, you know, we're all for workers' rights and, you know, things like that. It does seem like you kind of packed the chamber with city employees today, you know, maybe, and then you're saying you're at capacity, but if you look outside the chamber, it says the capacity is 234. And they're claiming that, well, there's reduced capacity because of the because of all the blocked off rows. So you're even admitting it. The whole reason you have all these rows blocked off is because you don't want to let the full amount of people you could potentially let in speak. And these barriers are ableist. They date back to when you were trying to keep people out because, you know, we were saying we were shutting down every meeting. And KDL still needs to go. He needs to resign, and you need to be doing something to get him out of office.
Thank you. I'm going to call a few more names. Dr. Jill Humphreys, Esther Cohen, Garrick Gillum, and Jason Madsen, please.
Good morning, Speaker. Which items would you like to speak on?
Items 21, 22, 23, 24, and general public comment.
Okay, you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment.
Mike Greenspan, Florida Gators, College World Series, UCLA, I don't. Well, let's go to 21. We're trying to hype neighborhood council participation over there in Council District 15. Let's go down memory lane. These neighborhood councils were set up as advisory councils. And as the late Harry Coleman said in the organizing stages, so the city could be advised on things they want to be advised on, i.e., it's not coming from the community. And now it's showing up. People aren't showing up because the city council is what counts. And in fact, Han, as mayor, tried to get the neighborhood councils to rah-rah for a tax increase. That's why people don't show up for neighborhood council. Well, item 22. Now, if we're transferring $3,680 from the street revenue fund for the special parking revenue fund, that means couches aren't getting picked up. Oh, well, we got enough homeless people. We don't want to take their furniture away. Shouldn't we be picking up the street furniture? Now, let's go to 24. We have used equipment, or I should say unused equipment. Now it's going to go right out to the landfill if we don't find another use for it. And so, yes, let's not put it to the landfill. Let's put it to use. Give it to a party that can use it. And let's go to 25. Hey, I knew of Juneteenth over 32 years ago from my cousins in Houston, Texas. Yes, they were celebrating it way back when. You guys are the last to come to the party. 26, to the victor goes the spoils. Geraldine Mendoza for the Board of Commissioners. If RIC KKK Caruso would have won, why, he would have put his people on. We know that. People like Mitchell Englander. Oh, he knows women really well. In fact, just ask, he went to Las Vegas to get his bribe. Money bribe, hotel room bribe, liquor bill bribe, pussy bribe. So he'd be great on the board of for the status of women, because he knows, oh, he knows from the every part of that woman, because his escort was there, and we paid for Englander salary to do that. General public comment. We have, a couple weeks ago, there was a Saturday meeting over at 5001 Obama. It was a transportation committee meeting. Councilmember Hernandez showed up. Councilmember Yaroslavsky showed up. Why, she even skipped the sermon from her scab rabbi at the synagogue on Shabbos. And the other one, Heather Hutt, showed up. We had a couple of no-shows, Nithya Ramen Noodle and Tracy Park Place. Even Officer Duarte showed up. Officer Graciano showed up. Officer Elongoria showed up. I showed up. I came all the way from the San Fernando Valley. But, you know, we couldn't get the races like Ramen Noodle and Park Place to show up because it was in a Schwarzen neighborhood. So let's talk about who the races are and who showed up. And guess what? Dr. Critical Turnkey, a.k.a. Mellow Desire, wasn't there either.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Dr. Jill M. Humphreys, public comment.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
Hi, my name is Dr. Jill M. Humphreys, and I am a native Black Angeleno. I'm also the inaugural author of the Los Angeles or the African Diplomatic Corps reception. I'm also most recently Fulbright Scholar representing the United States. I'm here because at least from February, probably up until about April or May, I spoke 4 times to the council regarding Councilman Price, regarding the ethics complaint that I filed in the stealing of my intellectual property. God don't like ugly. For the council, I just have to say I had no plans of coming and showing up, but I really wanted to just share, when I go teach in South Africa in a month, I'm going to use this as a case study. We are not the beacon. We are truly not the beacon of democracy. And for my Black council members, you did not respond to the Public Records Act's request. None of the Black council members. For those council members who did, thank you, namaste, for restoring at least some public trust. So I just want to say, Councilman Price, you still need to say thank you, apologize to my 90-year-old mom.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Garrett Gillum. General.
Okay, you have 1 minute.
My name is Garrett Gillum. I've worked for 17 years with the City of Los Angeles, SEIU Local 721. I work at the Harbor Department, and I'm a deckhand on the pilot boat at the pilot station. I work in Mr. McCosker's district. I'm part of a very small crew of people that keeps the cargo ships and traffic flowing in and out of the Port of Los Angeles. This crew kept everything running as normal through COVID, as we always have. Throughout the course of my 17-year employment, I have noticed that my union, Local 721, has always worked with the city to keep things running. Employees have taken pay decrease, or have not taken pay increases or held off on our pay increases to help the city. In my 17 years, we have never had to vote for a strike authorization. I would like to finish if I could.
Thank you, sir.
My brothers and sisters.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, I'm sorry your time has expired. Thank you very much. Sorry about that. Next speaker, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Baby Bobo, number one fan. And I signed up for all available items. Can you just remind me, please, because I was outside the whole time?
Of course. So the items that are open for public comment are 21 through 26. So you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public
comment. Also, just for point of information, I did sign up under a name that Kahorian called out. I was just being silly when I said right now. So don't think I'm up here just like jumping the queue.
Okay.
Sorry, that's important. So item number 21. Ms. Cosker Hernandez, I don't trust Hernandez anymore because she turned her back on the gay community and she used a ship of Theseus argument, which is like freshman year college bullshit, where it's, oh, if every piece on the ship gets replaced, is it the same ship? That's insane. Item number 22, Hutt and Price. I don't have anything wrong personally with Heather Hutt. She seems like a really nice person. It just sucks the way that she got put into her chair and she is caught in the middle of all this because she seems like, honestly, seems like one of the most genuine people on the board, on the whole council. But Price, the public has been warning you guys about his ethics violation, the corruption for a long time. And I've been hearing about the stuff about the two wives in the public, and I thought they were being silly religious people, but I guess they were right. That's pretty crazy. So every motion, every item that's been put forward with Price on it needs to be, especially involving money, needs to be reevaluated because we can't trust any of those motions. 25, Harris Dawson McCosker. Harris Dawson turned his back when a black person was getting arrested here once. That was crazy. He was elderly, probably even older than Harris Dawson. Harris Dawson championed through the Plum Committee giving public land to the Marriott Hotel in the middle of a housing emergency. Pretty wild. And he's going to use his corruption to wiggle his way into vice president pro tem, which is pretty nuts when you think about it. So if we're going to be honest here and be adults, since Santa Claus isn't real, then let's keep it real here, y'all. Stop disrespecting our intelligence as the public when we're telling you things that later on end up being true. And then you're removed for those reasons. Item number 26, communication from the mayor, appointing someone on the Board of Commissioners on the status of women. The status of women is that they're homeless, they're being beat up by I guess like their spouses in the fire department or police department. I don't know how that went, but they're beating up each other now that there's chicks all up in the offices. Women are homeless, trans, they're being rejected and evicted. That's the status of women. And I was here one day and an old lady came up here, said she was a landlord. She's homeless now. And I yelled at you guys for not sending anybody to see her from the offices. And then I was told that like, I had to be removed. I was removed because no one sent anybody to the lady to talk to her. Is this my public comment or am I still in the items? Am I still in the items? Or is this public comment?
You can continue with the item, but please make sure that you're talking about
yes.
the item.
So like I was saying about the items, about the status of women, is that it's pretty dismal, and that just putting a woman in charge of something called the Board of Status of Women doesn't fix women's issues. I mean, if you're just going to champion the same systems and processes that keep women like beat up and shit, like what are you even doing? That's pretty wild. And if you're going to fight laws that give women the ability to defend themselves with a firearm, you're a part of the problem. You're the reason why women are afraid and shit, because they can't defend themselves, because they can't even go and get a gun. That they can't even go get a 22 and walk around with it in their purse to defend themselves from people that might rob them, human traffic them, or a police officer or a fire department person or anybody beating them up because they're dating them. General public comment. I don't get into people's personal stuff. That's why I don't talk about any of you guys' personal things. I try to keep it pretty civil, even though it might not seem like it. I don't get into your business, your family issues, his wife, her husband used to write for this or produce this thing or Modern Family or whatever the fuck. I went to Harvard. I don't care about that. All I care about is that we have a lot of resources available to house and give people what they need right now without adding anything extra. All we have to do is use what we have for the people that need it now and stop acting like Santa Claus isn't real. We know the profit incentive behind like home ownership and property ownership. We know that that's the main reason, the developer lobby is the main reason why we can't use what we have now to house people that need it now. There's over 100,000 vacant units, you refuse to use that, and you talk about your allocated budgets, and you just sit there talking, having your side conversations, and you don't pay attention during public comment, and it really hurts. And I voted for you. I fucking voted for you, and it's really sad. And just going that, that doesn't help. You need to be sitting there. You need to be.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Next speaker, please. Thank you. Your time's expired. Next speaker, please.
Good morning.
Okay. Have a seat and be silent so other members of the public can speak.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Hi, good morning. My name is Jason Madsen. I think it was general comment. I can't remember whichever the top one was. General comment, maybe.
Okay, so you have 1 minute for general public comment.
Okay. So I'm a heavy duty equipment mechanic for the City of Los Angeles, MOU 14 SEIU. And as you guys saw today, there was a lot of us here today on our own personal time to show you guys that we are being affected by this, by our contract. So we're looking for you guys to get with the CAO, get with the, I think it's the ERC, I'm not sure the name for the budget committee, and try to get this moved along. We've kind of been strung along for, we were supposed to be starting bargaining after a quick contract on January 2023. We are now in June, middle of June, we still don't have our contract completed. We continue to get kind of strung along, and I think everybody's pretty much fed up with it. This is the first time we've had a strike vote, and 98% of our members voted for that. Today there's a lot of services that have been stopped since 9:30, 8:30 for us to get here, and that's just a little taste of what everybody's feeling to get this taken care of. So if you guys could maybe put a little pressure, if we need to do some more pressure, that way it kind of gets handled, because we're all feeling that way.
Thank you, sir. Next speaker, please.
Good morning. Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
It'll be public comment. I actually signed under I'm not Goat Puppet's son.
So you have 1 minute for general public comment.
Okay, thank you very much. The issue at hand is I attempted to submit for my client a personnel complaint to the LAPD. There's a new operation procedure in which I thought a little shocking. It goes to the union first before it goes into internal affairs. According to the new operating procedure, in which the sergeant was nice enough to do on a business card, it goes to a mitigation before it goes to internal affairs. I don't read the dissent decree or the standard operation procedures in the LA manual that way. And I've attempted through my counsel lady to get more clarification. And the position with the council lady, Rahman, is talk to the city attorney. This, I have a business card here from the sergeant that says everything goes through the union, and they actually contacted me. And I'd like to get more clarification. Thank you.
Thank you. Rob Kwan, Herman, Stacy Cigar Bollinger, please.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
I'd like to speak on items 22, 24, 25, 26, and general public comment.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment.
Okay, so item 22 is a motion from Hutt and Price. Considering the news regarding Councilmember Price, I think it should be a red flag whenever we see his name next to a funding motion. But I was curious about this motion, so I thought, I don't know what the street furniture revenue fund is, because we're using public parking spaces and they're saying we need to transfer 3,600 and change from one account into another to compensate for the public parking. With this is parking that we own, so I don't really understand why we need to pay ourselves for that anyway. But I said, what is the Street Furniture Revenue Fund? What does that even do? So that is the fund, for anyone else who, like me, didn't know this morning. When you see an ad on a bus stop or a park bench or something like that, money is collected and it's supposed to go to maintain things like public toilets and park benches and shade for bus stops. So here what we have is money being taken away from funding for things that our city is seriously lacking: benches, shade, public toilets, and saying, let's give it to these parking spaces that we're gonna take up for a mural, which I love art, I love murals, but why are we taking funding away from something that is so lacking to compensate for parking? Okay, I'm eating up my time here. 24, I'm just noticing that we're able to transport items and funding from one agency to another. So in this instance, CERT trainings are great. That's the Community Emergency Response Team. It's run by volunteers. It's attended by volunteers who want to make their community a great place. Awesome program. So we're sending surplus PPE from the Port of LA into the CERT program. Now, those agencies have nothing to do with each other. So why I'm bringing this up is because I've had a lot of conversations with my representatives. When I say this agency has all this funding and resources and these ones are lacking, they act like they're totally separate, that they have nothing to do with each other, they don't inform each other, but then we have these motions. Let's give some masks from the port to the fire department. Great. Why don't we have that energy when we are looking at funding for the unhoused, for things that the city really needs, healthcare, things like that. 25 and 26. It's just really a joke that this body is pretending to care about racism at all. and I think that's obviously why. And 26 is, oh yeah, the status of women, fucking shitty. It's not good. Trans women are some of the highest to most likely to have a hate crime committed against them in the city. We don't have healthcare. We don't have childcare. We have working single moms who have no time, no money, can't pay their rent. So again, these motions are jokes. You do a lot of talking and then your actions do not back up the words that are in this document. So moving on to general public comment, I sent an email and tried to reach by phone Meg Healy from Council Member 4's or CD4's housing department. I've told a lot of stories to people in that council district about my slumlord, Michael Goodrich, who during the pandemic tried to get my elderly neighbor to self-evict, telling her that her elderly mother, who was bedridden, was a liability and you need to move and you have 60 days. Now, they did this under an eviction moratorium. Now, sadly, my neighbor's bedridden mother passed not very long after that. But recently, that woman who still lives there, who's lived there since before the current owner, Michael Goodrich, slumlord, owned that building, her fridge broke and he refused to replace it. Said, that's not part of your lease. She had to spend $400 to get a new fridge and now she's going to food banks because she can't afford groceries. So if someone from your department could get back to me, if Meg could get back to me, Nithya, that would be great.
Thank you. Next speaker, please. Sir, this is the second time I'm going to tell you, be quiet and sit down. Stop disrupting the meeting. Stop talking. You are disrupting this meeting.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please tell us the items you would like to speak on.
I want to speak on all item on non-general public comment, so attorney.
So the items that are open for public comment are 21 through 26. You have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment.
Okay. I speak right now, okay? Hold up. Hold the shit. Regarding green bin, I support all the workers that were here for union and I support them and you know.
That's not on the agenda. Stick with the agenda or move on to general public comment.
Now, as far as the banners, as far as a street banner campaign, you know, us stakeholders want to believe we can support this shit off of the Wilmington community, but motherfuckers, please use my sign to demonstrate the kind of banners we need in our communities like this. This way you fools will understand that we are all alike. And then on item on banner Echo Park. Is that how you pronounce it? Park? Park, you? Oh, yeah. No. 22, nigga. Hutt and Price, project located in Vermont. Another presentation for funding for fucking mural. I support fucking mural. You see, I wear my design mural for the public to understand I too a white nigga like you, Juju. Then I go to item on 23, another street banner. Now the guy up there smoking his pipe and bong, you're very funny. I like your presentation. But here we're talking about Soto. That's a street right here in Boyle Heights, and Miss Yogorskoski, who's right there laughing with ramen noodle there. Regarding street banner, I want a street banner to represent people who suffer from eating disorder, like ramen noodle. And then we go to item 25. Oh, my God. My hero, Frederick Douglass. Yes, we need banners to demonstrate what Frederick Douglass did for this fucking country. Frederick Douglass, a slave, showed the world how a nigga gets into the White House to prove that he, a slave who murdered a man like OJ, can do it right. And that's the reason why I support the banner, and not the Armenian banner, but the Turkish banners, because we support Frederick Douglass, and I love my African neighbors because they know goddamn right current price and CD9 fuck you over. Now into my general public comment, you faggot. So, U.S. Supreme Court, Brandenburg versus Ohio, U.S. 395-444, regarding how far is the nigger going to, yeah? This is what we're going to go to the niggers, a dirty nigger. Let's give them back to the dark garden. Send the Jews back to Israel. Juju. For this reason, in this court opinion, Mr. Attorney, in this court opinion, the motherfucker says save America. Save America from the goddamn Chinese disease of COVID. And that jackass, stupid rubber stamp, Armenian motherfucker too. Because the budget doesn't help people get off the street. The fucking budget by that fucking dumbass Canoga Park and that fucking pussy-ass Armenian prove that I'm right.
Next speaker, please. Step away from the podium. Next speaker, please. Herman, step away from the podium.
Good morning, Speaker. If you could please remind us of the name that you signed up under and the items you would like to speak on.
Morning, and baby Fob, I got a deal. If you let us know your last name, I'm happy to promote you to that
just
title.
Go ahead and tell us what agenda items you want to speak on, and or go to general public comment.
General public comment, and the offer's still okay. There.
You have 1 minute.
I've heard a lot of buck passing from y'all the last few days, and you should look at yourselves. Charter section 222 gave you the clear authority to intervene with Mr. Price. Any one of you, via charter, could have requested the city attorney opine on whether he needed to recuse himself. Obviously, you were all too scared to speak up and say that aloud, but you could have walked right over to him and said, hey, look, Curran, if you don't recuse yourself, I'm going to have to ask the city attorney to weigh in. And what have you done to address these issues? You introduced a motion in the fall to look at charter ethics reform and haven't touched the thing in 8 months. I've tried politely to convey that you need to take that up, and those calls are going to get a whole hell of a lot less polite going forward. Your government reform committee has decided to take a 2-month break from its main work, so if you want to take it up and have multiple hearings and hammer it out there, go for it. But personally, I don't trust your process. I don't trust the way you're handling redistricting, not casting a single goddamn vote, and having John Wickham go behind closed doors to hammer out compromise without any public direction. Really, you can't be trusted to reform yourselves, and you should send that thing back to the Ethics Commission.
Thank you. Is there any other speakers that are called? Okay, that'll close public comment here in the chambers. Yeah, I'm sorry, we've taken public comment for nearly an hour, and you also signed up very late, so stop disrupting the meeting, be silent or you'll be removed. Let's go to the phones for the first speaker. Listen, no, there's no points of information. Just because you sign up does not guarantee an opportunity to speak. I've taken public comment for nearly an hour. Mr. Spindler, you are ordered to be not disrupt this meeting or you'll be removed. Let's go to the first caller on the phone. Ms. Sagara Bollinger, you are instructed not to disrupt the meeting. Go to the first caller on the phone now.
First caller, which items would you like to speak on?
Public, I'll speak on items 19, 20, 25, and general comments. Item 22, this item is by hand-picked Uncle Tom Kuhn Heather Hutt for $3,600 mural. That is what the black community needs. A stupid $3,000 mural. When Bloomfield puts forth and gets multi-million dollar mobile emergency drug treatment unit for his people, Nori Martinez, petty pink-faced dictator Paul Krikorian selected Heather Hutt, comes up with a $3,600 mural. I demand a no vote on this nothing mural. Heather Hutt should not be allowed to vote on this item because she has not been democratically elected by the people, but only installed by pink-faced corrupt Armenian dictator Paul Krikorian, who has thrown more members of the public out of sleazy hall meetings in the last couple of months than in the entire history of the city of L.A. The year 1781. Lockup, Herman Price and Ridley Thomas and Sleazy Dawson. Item 23 is regarding a street banner program. Again, I demand that Heather Hutt not be allowed to vote on this item because she was not elected to represent the community and the people. The black coon sellouts on this corrupt council, Price, Sleazy, Marquise Dawson, Heather, do not represent the needs of the black people. Black coons sit in 20% of the council seats when we are only 12% of the population. We are double represented public. Then why are we nearly 50% of the homeless, the incarcerated, and unemployed? 24 is a motion by extremely short, rounded-headed boy Sleazy Marquise Dawson, who we predict to be the next corrupt, self-serving Uncle Tom to be indicted and should therefore receive a no vote on this item, just like there should have been a unanimous no vote on Council File 18-0957 when Dawson tried to take the black community's unemployment office for his personal office space. General comment. This racist, incompetent, and corrupt city government is going to try to again cramming the Hyundai car company LAPD robot down our throats. The public does not need this. The LAPD killer robot dog of oppression. We the people don't want the Hyundai car company LAPD robot dog killer robot dog now. Yes, Hyundai is responsible for this attempted oppression of minority communities. Yes, boycott Hyundai, the car company, which owns Boston Dynamics, the maker of the LAPD killer robot dog of oppression machines. Join us in our boycott of Hyundai. Boycott Hyundai. Call Hyundai Car Company and tell them you are boycotting their cars for their attempted oppression of our minority communities via the LAPD. These coon toms blacks on the sleazy council do not represent us. Indicted Karen Price, Sleazy Corrupt Little Man Dawson, and Heather Hutt.
Thank you. Both next caller, please.
Caller, which items would you like to speak on?
I would like to speak on 21, 22, 25, 26, and general public comment.
Okay, so you have 3 minutes for the items and 1 minute for general public comment.
All right, thank you. For 21, why not add a banner for smoke and scan? the people in the neighborhood could learn a lot if they spend a little bit of time with us on Smoke and Scan. Happy birthday, Mom, of Smoke and Scan. 22, I think you should add Stinks to the mural. He's a tuxedo cat. They're really the cutest, and why not? Number 25, the banner campaign commemorating the emancipation of enslavement. For the people that are using this to talk about reparations, if we wanted to be serious to talk about the evidence, we might compare where blacks stood 100 years after the end of slavery and where they stood 30 years after liberal welfare. In other words, we could compare hard evidence to the legacy of slavery with hard evidence to the legacy of liberals. 26, the status of women. Seeing the beta males that show up to the council meeting, it's no surprise that Stacey says the status of women sucks. If they watch Smoke and Scan, the status of women would get better. One chase a week is shown to increase your testosterone. To general public comment, it says you guys have 5 vacant positions on the Climax Emergency Commission. Watching the people that show up to the council meeting every week, it's no surprise that there is a Climax emergency plaguing the ladies of LA. I would like to throw my hat into the ring for one of the vacant positions. I don't want to brag, but Brock Landers has helped a fair amount of ladies through Climax emergencies. Not stingy with the lingus. If appointed, though I would only occupy one position, Brock Landers is proficient in a plethora of positions. You want to be treated as burdensome when you come to Brock Landers to get through your Climax emergency. Brock Landers will work tirelessly, pounding the way to get as many ladies as I can through the Climax emergency. Brock Landers is going to work so hard that we're going to have a walking fun emergency when I'm done. Eric Previn for City Council.
Thank you. Next caller, please.
Next caller, which items would you like to speak on?
Hi, good afternoon.
Hi.
Hello?
We can hear you. Which items would you like to speak on?
Which item? Today, I would like to speak on general public comment, please.
Okay, you have 1 minute. Please begin.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Mr. Kerkorian, where is the democracy in the city of Los Angeles? Because as a council member, you should take public comment from everyone who signed up for public comment, in chambers and by telephone. This is not democracy when you're telling your constituents of the city of Los Angeles, we've taken public comment for more than an hour, and just because you signed up, it doesn't mean you get to speak. That's not right, Mr. Corrin. There's no democracy right there. What's going on? What a sham that we have. This council's a sham. Now we have a fourth council member indicted on federal corruption charges. How interesting is that? You know, the people of Los Angeles have lost trust in you folks. Man, I don't understand what's going on.
Thank you. That'll close public comment on all agenda items and general public comment. Madam Clerk, what's available for us to vote on?
The council may now vote on items 21 and 23 through 26.
Ms. Segarra Bollinger, I've warned you before, you will not disrupt this meeting or you'll be removed. I'm sorry, Madam Clerk, we couldn't hear what items were before us.
The council may now vote on items 21 and 23 through 26.
Those items are now before us. Members, are there any members who wish to be heard on those items? Seeing none, let's go ahead and open the roll. Close the roll and tabulate the votes.
10 ayes.
Thank you. That will take us then next to item number 4, which was called special by Councilmember Soto Martinez for comments. Councilmember Soto Martinez, item 4.
I did it for Mrs. Councilmember Rahman.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No,
okay.
No, no. He called it special because I was at finishing up my
AQMD
meeting. And I wanted to call this special because I just wanted to alert people to the fact that AB 1383, which is moving forward in implementation, I want to make sure that this council's eyes are on it as it's moving through our city moving through implementation and ensuring that our businesses, our commercial customers, and our home customers have the capacity to be able to engage with this program in a really successful way. For those of you who don't know, SB 1383 was passed essentially to remove organics from our waste stream to reduce emissions. So organics make up a huge amount of our waste stream, and it results in methane emissions, which are really bad for our environment. I don't know if I should even...
Yeah, just hold on a second, Councilmember Rahman. Mr. Harlan, if you could please not disrupt the meeting. Councilmember Rahman is speaking. Go right ahead.
But I did want to flag that because of the way in which our commercial recycling programs are structured, some of our larger commercial account holders, which are responsible for a great deal of our organics waste, including multifamily residential buildings, so all of our apartments, are nervous about the new program because it's going to be more costly, potentially. And so this is a motion that really wants to make sure that commercial customers are not incurring additional fees as a result of how we're responding to new 1383 regulations here. So just wanted to flag that for everyone, because I know it's not on everyone's agenda, but I do think a lot of your small businesses and a lot of your multifamily units are probably dealing with it, if anyone. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. Does anybody else wish? Sir, if you want to have a conversation, take it outside so we can proceed with our work. All right. Anybody else wishing to be heard on this? Seeing none, let's go ahead and open the roll. I'm sorry, Mr. Kwan, you spoke. I'm not going to have this meeting disrupted by people who want to have a conversation. We took public comment for over an hour. That's it. We're done with public comment. Mr. Kwan, do not disrupt this meeting. I'm telling you. You are done. You're disrupting the meeting. This guy, pursuant to Rule 12, please remove him from the meeting for continuing to disrupt, despite five warnings at least. Ms. Segarra-Bollinger, you too. Remove Ms. Segarra-Bollinger pursuant to Rule 12. She's excluded from this meeting. Enough is enough. Do you want it?
And for the record, please note that the gentleman in the black shirt is still refusing to leave the meeting after receiving multiple
warnings. The gentleman in the black shirt is continuing to disrupt the meeting despite my order that he be removed. Next item, what's now before us?
That would be item 22.
I'm trying really hard, Mr. Kwan. Please.
I'm sorry, item number 4, if you would like to take the votes.
Item number 22, as amended, is now before us. Is there any member wishing to be heard on item 22? Councilmember Hutt.
Mr. Chair, the button wouldn't work. Mr. President, I'd like a technical amendment added to item number 22. Mr. City Attorney, can you read in the technical amendment, please, for the record?
So, Councilmember Hutt, I believe we read this in earlier, but I can...
You know what? I'm sorry.
No worries.
It's been a rough day. Thank you.
Okay. So on item 22, as amended, let's go ahead and open the roll. Close the roll and tabulate the votes.
10 ayes.
Thank you. And now, with the various distractions that were happening, after there was the presentation by Councilmember Rahman on item 4, I neglected to call it for a vote. So let's go ahead and return to item number 4. Is there anybody else wishing to be heard? Seeing none, let's go ahead and open the roll. Close the roll and tabulate the votes.
10 ayes.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, what is now before us?
Thank you. Now the council has motions for posting and referral.
Without objection, posted and referred.
The desk is clear.
Thank you very much. Members, are there any announcements? Councilmember Hutt, followed by Councilmember Hernandez, followed by Councilmember Harris Dawson.
Thank you. I think I have a graphic. Do I have a graphic? Yeah, there it is. All right. This Monday is Juneteenth, ladies and gentlemen, and I want to share and invite you all to join us for a weekend to celebrate. Tomorrow, we're partnering with Nike Keep It Run 100 to host a 5K in Leimert Park Village. So come run and jog with us. This immersive experience will celebrate Black joy, resilience, recovery, fitness, wellness, and artistry. And then at 11 a.m., we'll be celebrating and co-naming Jefferson Boulevard as New Orleans Corridor. This event makes a significant milestone in conserving the history of Black people who came from Louisiana to Los Angeles during the Great Migration via the Sunset Route. Mayor Bass and Mayor Cantrell from New Orleans will join us for the celebration of unifying these cities. The ribbon cutting will take place at 11 a.m., followed by a second line parade. This is at Holy Name Church on Jefferson. The address is 1977 West Jefferson. And then on Monday, we have the beloved annual Juneteenth Festival in Leimert Park. On this day, it'll be historical. We're expecting lots of folks out there. And we have Jasmine Sullivan in the evening to be our artist. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Hutt. I'm sorry, Councilmember Hernandez.
Thank you, Council President. I just want to give a quick shout out that this Saturday on June 17th, it's Global Garbage Man Day, a day to uplift our garbage collectors. Here in the city of Los Angeles, we have refuse collection truck operators, RCTOs. I got to meet some of our RCTOs yesterday, some local ones in my neighborhood, and they just talked about their stories around how during COVID-19, they were one of the departments and some of the workers that never took time off. They were consistently working through the pandemic, and I just want to make sure that we can uplift them. And quick side note, there are a few things that you can do to make their job easier. When you pull out your trash cans, make sure that they are 3 feet apart from the other trash cans or cars and sidewalks. That just makes their job a lot easier. Thank you so much for letting me uplift them, and let's all celebrate them.
Thank you. Councilmember Harris Dawson.
Thank you so much, members. And I want to join Councilwoman Hutt in inviting everybody, the entire council, to our Juneteenth celebration on Monday afternoon. It'll be a fun event there in Leimert Park in the Crenshaw District, as well as the Louisiana event. My family comes from Louisiana, so we're very, very excited. That's why my name is Marquise. We're very, very excited, and congratulations to Councilwoman Hutt for that event as well. Also, last night we got to honor Mr. Luis Moreno from the Department of Sanitation as the leader of our teams that pick up bulky items in the area. There was a Board of Public Works held their meeting in South LA last night. And I will tell you, Councilwoman Hutt, Councilwoman McCosker, we heard complaints about sidewalks and tree trimming and potholes, but constituent after constituent stood up and said, when we call about bulky items, sanitation shows up right away. And so we were very proud to recognize him and recognize the Day of Refuse Workers. Also on this coming Saturday, beginning at 9 a.m. at Jesse Owens Park, at the Mark Ridley Thomas Constituency Center at 84th in Vermont, we will both cut the ribbon for our district office, which had been closed during the pandemic up until now. We'll cut the ribbon for that and have a grand opening. And this will also be where Ciclovia will kick off. So a bunch of us will be riding bicycles up and down the street and celebrating transportation, celebrating family, as well as the opening of our district office there on Vermont and 84th Street. So everybody's welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilmember Rahman.
I just wanted to rise, you know, I think I want to hold space this month. It's Pride Month for queer joy, for the celebration of love that we have during Pride Month. And I saw so many of you this past weekend at Pride, and it was incredible. But I also just want to underscore that we are facing a grim reality right now in LA that homophobia, bigotry, and LGBTQ plus hate are intensified during this moment. And I think it's important to acknowledge that in these chambers. It's been deeply unsettling to me. Today we introduced a resolution to reaffirm that the city of Los Angeles stands in solidarity with the LGBTQIA plus community in condemning recent acts of hate. But I just wanted to stand up and speak those words out to this body. Recent incidents at Sataquoy Elementary, the protests at the Glendale Unified School District board meeting, the destruction, repeated destruction of pride flags on the Shakespeare Bridge in my district, the disruption of a drag queen story hour at the Sherman Oaks Library. All of these are incidents that I never thought we would see happening in the city of Los Angeles, and yet here we are. And I think it's really, really important this month, but also every month, to speak our truth, which is that in this city, we stand up against acts of homophobia and violence. We stand up against all of this hate. This resolution is just a resolution, but it is just a small piece of what I know all of us can do and must do in our own communities to ensure that Los Angeles continues to be a place of love and welcoming for everyone, including every member of our vibrant LGBTQIA+ community. Thank you.
Councilmember McCosker.
Thank you very much. In CD 15, I just want to talk a little bit about our Juneteenth celebrations, and we have a Pride celebration. So tomorrow at Peck Park in San Pedro, we'll have a Juneteenth. So Peck Park is our local regional park down in the south end. And that will start at 10 a.m. And also tomorrow, we'll have our Pride on the Port event, which will be at the beginning at the Maritime Museum down on the waterfront. So it'll go all day on the waterfront. So I'll be going back and forth between Pride and Juneteenth. And then on Monday, we will have a Pride celebration in Watts at the historic train station. So there's lots of great events. I want to make sure that everybody has an opportunity to celebrate Freedom Day, as well as continue celebrating Pride. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other announcements, members? All right. Seeing no other announcements, are there motions to adjourn in memory? Councilmember Park.
Thank you, Council President.
If we could all
please
rise for adjournments.
It is with profound respect and deep sadness that today we honor the life of a valued member of the CD11 community, a scientist who devoted 36 years to NASA, Dr. Firouz Nideri. And I would like to welcome his friends and family who are with us this morning in council chambers. Dr. Nideri was born in Shiraz, Iran, and came to the United States for college in 1964. He received his undergraduate degree at Iowa State University and his master's and PhD at the University of Southern California. All of his degrees were in electrical engineering. He returned to Iran for 3 years to work for the Iranian Remote Sensing Agency, but left after the revolution in 1979. Since then, he worked in various technical and executive positions at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, including as the director of Solar System Exploration, where he was in charge of the many programs and projects that pushed the understanding of our galaxy. During his career at JPL, Dr. Nideri managed the Origins program in its search for Earth-like planets. This led him to his role as the head of the Mars Exploration Program for 5 years, where he launched 6 successful Mars landings, including the rovers Spirit and Opportunity. He also led the launch of the Mars Odyssey spacecraft that is still in orbit today. In 2005, Dr. Nideri was named Associate Director of the Project Formulation and Strategy, which was followed by his final position as Director for Solar System Exploration. In this role, he sent robotic missions to Jupiter, Saturn, asteroids, and Europa, and led the formation of the first ever Mars helicopter. He received numerous awards for his work, including NASA's Outstanding Leadership Medal, Space Technology Hall of Fame Medal, and NASA's most prestigious award, the Distinguished Service Medal, upon his retirement in 2016. The International Astronomical Union even renamed an asteroid after him. Dr. Nideri was a great boon to the scientific community, but also a pivotal figure in the Iranian-American community. Because of his deep commitment to the Iranian-American youth in our community, Dr. Nideri mentored thousands of Iranian-Americans and young scientists during his lifetime. Along with his many scientific awards, Dr. Nideri also received the Ellis Island Medal of Honor in 2003 and the Great Immigrants Pride of America Award from the Carnegie Corporation of New York in 2015. Dr. Firouz Nideri's position and his prominence among Iranians was elevated as he fully leveraged his credibility and humility in echoing the voices of Iranian youth in their fight for freedom. On June 9th, 2023, Los Angeles lost Dr. Nideri, one of the most decorated and influential scientists and Iranian Americans who made a major mark in space exploration and advancing human knowledge. May he rest in peace.
Thank you very much, Councilmember Park, for that adjournment in memory of an extraordinary life, and our condolences are with his family and friends. Any other motions to adjourn, members? All right. Well, wish you all a happy Juneteenth. I wish you all a happy Father's Day, and with that, this meeting is adjourned.